I'm 41 years old, and I've been brought up in the church, sat in countless times seeing sermons, Bible studies, etc. That's the first time I've ever seen someone stand at the front of a church and talk about the dire situation that we are in. I hope that's different for you. Over the last 6 months, I've been reading a number of the scientific reports. I've read key books and I've watched many documentaries and lectures from leading scientists. Although I'm not a climate scientist, and I'm not particularly what I might call a tree hugger. Yeah? I'm not someone who has sort of been brought up with this environmental protest stuff. I want to give you a rough summary which is representative of the view of 98% of climate scientists. It's very much going to support what Simon is saying. If we continue with anything like our current levels of carbon emissions, we face a future which includes mass starvation, global migration, and societal collapse. This will affect just about everybody we know and love. And it's already affecting some of the poorest in the world. If we don't significantly reduce our carbon emissions, we will perhaps see these events. I'm going to say it again, because our brains are designed to deflect this. Starvation, mass migration, and societal collapse. We're going to see these events perhaps unfold within my lifetime, but almost certainly within the lifetime of my children. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, said that we have a decade to radically decarbonize our societies, or we will reap horrific consequences that are not compatible with human life. A decade. The Secretary General of the UN spoke these words at a gathering last September. Climate change is the defining issue of our time, and we are at a defining moment. We face a direct existential threat. Climate change is moving faster than we are, and its speed has provoked a sonic boom, SOS, across our world. If we do not change course by 2020, the UN Secretary General is saying if we do not change course by 2020, we risk missing the point where we can avoid runaway climate change, with disastrous consequences for people and all the natural systems that sustain us. Back in April, after 1,000 arrests of Extinction Rebellion protesters, our government unanimously declared a climate emergency. It's almost as if nobody's actually challenging the science. And yet, our government have done nothing close to the action required to prevent this disaster. Let me give you an example. Heathrow emits 18 million tons of CO2 a year. Around the world, there are 118 countries whose total emissions are less than that of Heathrow Airport. And yet, the plans are still in place to build a third runway, which will cause an extra 7.3 million tons of CO2 a year. It is not an exaggeration to say we are being failed by our government. We are being failed by most of the media. Because for some of us, this is the first time we're hearing this scenario. Something has gone wrong. And money and profit is driving us to destruction. Furthermore, if all carbon emissions were stopped now, and that's not going to happen, if they all stopped now, we would still be seeing a temperature increase and its devastating effects for the next 10 to 15 years. A temperature increase is already locked into the system. And it gets even worse. Temperature increase is not a linear increase with the increase in emissions. So if you add a bit of emissions, then you get a bit of temperature. It's not linear. No, it's more like exponential growth. Exponential temperature rise, and that's due to positive feedback loops. Let me give you an example of many of these. Here's one. Ice reflects sunlight back to space. An increase in temperature through carbon emissions melts the ice. Therefore, there is less ice to reflect back the sunlight, and so there's a further increase in temperature, which in turn melts the ice. There is no way, if I am to tell the truth to you, to sugarcoat this message and how dire this situation is. And I'm a Christian. I pledge my allegiance to Jesus. In a few moments, we're going to have a time of prayer. And then we're going to talk about what the church should be doing at this desperate hour. Thank you.
So we are going to move into a time of lament in a few minutes. But I just wanted to hit the pause button after we've heard some hard-hitting facts, maybe heard them for the 10th time, 100th time, maybe a reminder of things that we already know. Maybe there's some new information there. And those facts lead to feelings, lead to us reacting. As humans, we are full of emotions, and I think it's worth checking in with those and how we're feeling. So what I'd like to do is spend 2 minutes doing that. If you could get into pairs, I'd like you to spend 1 minute speaking to the person next to you about how what you've heard makes you feel. Now, the temptation when you're doing this is to move into what you're going to do or what that makes you want to change or what that makes you want to challenge. But it would be really good if you could just spend that minute sitting with your feelings and talking about how you feel as a response to seeing those videos of the seas rising, to seeing the graphs with the lines going in the wrong direction, to hearing about the global justice impacts. How are you feeling? So if you could spend 1 minute talking to somebody sitting next to you, I'll let you know when that minute's up, and then swap. If you could do that uninterrupted, just talking about how that is making you feel, I will bring us back together and lead into the time of lament in a moment. So if you want to get into pairs and have a go at that, off you go.
Ladies and gents, I was at a prayer meeting talking about this the other evening. I added the line, and if you've come with someone who they're okay with this, give them a cuddle and hold their hand. Because it's awful. I work with vulnerable adults. I don't want them because they've got enough on a bit of know the full extent. I have young children, and they are joining the marches, they're doing the posters, the recycling. It has not dawned on them anywhere near, even though they talk about it, the full extent of the problem. And so we're going to pray together. If you're able, could I invite you to stand? So what's going to happen? I'm going to lead us in some prayers, so some responses. So when I say, Lord, have mercy, could you respond with the words, Christ, have mercy? And then I've retweaked an old confession because some of the feelings I have, I'm upset, I'm sad for a future which may not exist or the way that I would want it to be. I'm sad, I'm angry, I'm furious. People have known about this for years. Known about it for years. And I feel guilty. My life is caught up and complicit with the carbon going in the atmosphere. Even now I've realized it. Even now I've woken up, still complicit. So when I say the words, Lord, have mercy, could you respond with the words, Christ, have mercy? Climate change is real. Desmond Tutu said this 25 years ago. People could be excused for not knowing much or doing much about climate change. Today, we have no excuse. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Climate change is happening now. Poorest countries are the most vulnerable. Lord, have mercy. Climate change requires extensive and sustained action to prevent the unfolding of a disaster of apocalyptic proportions. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. A prayer of confession. Almighty God, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought, word, and deed, through negligence, through consumerism, by being caught up and complicit in economic systems and lifestyles which bring destruction. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Amen. There's an opportunity now as a video plays with some music in the background. Scripture is spoken over us. There's an opportunity to come to the front and to, if you're up for it, to come and kneel, stand around here, and take a candle representing your prayers and your anguish, and to light it and place it on one of the stations here. And also, if you do need to sit down, that's fine as well. So, thank you, Martin.
the joy of our hearts has ceased. Our dancing has been turned to mourning. The crown has fallen from our head. Woe to us, for we have sinned. For this our heart has become sick. For these things our eyes have grown dim. For Mount Zion, which lies desolate, jackals prowl over it. But you, O Lord, you reign forever. Your throne endures to all generations. Why do you forget us forever? Why do you forsake us for so many days? Restore us to yourself, O Lord, that we may be restored.
Though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the yields in the field yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation.
For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.